Hey, this is Hammock from KVGM The Last Wave, and you're listening to Pixelated Audio, and today we're listening to Kaze no Notam on the Sony PlayStation.
Welcome back to Pixelated Audio, a podcast focusing on game audio, its history, and the people behind it. We're your hosts. I'm Brian, and this is Gene.
Hey.
And today we are going to be talking about and playing music from a game called Kaze no Notam from the Sony PlayStation. And this is a super chill soundtrack, and I'm really excited to dig into it today.
Yeah, this actually isn't our pick. We have a very special guest joining us on the show today. We've got Hammock from KVGM.
Hey, what's up?
Hey, how you doing?
How's it going?
Good.
Hey, welcome to the show, dude. This is kind of a long overdue collaboration, I think. And
yeah,
so I'm excited.
We've been longtime listeners of your show, and I think you've listened to ours a few times, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. I appreciate you guys checking out the show. And yeah, I've been a longtime listener as well. You are part of the holy triumvirate of video game music podcast that really got me back into listening to video game music. So
nice.
Thanks for having me on the show. This is a big honor.
Yeah, well, and so you are like one of the kind of new up and coming VGM podcasts that are keeping us inspired to keep creating stuff. So this is awesome. It's a great community, and you know, you're really active in Discord, and I love that. And just, I feel like we're all big, you know, part of this big family. So the more kind of collaborations and stuff we can do with in our community, I think the better too. So
yeah, absolutely. Very cool.
For those of you who don't know Hammock's show, it's kind of around this kind of laid back chill vibe. Could you tell us about your show a little bit?
Yeah, so it's KVGM, The Last Wave, and you know, for me, there's a lot of video game music that I like and enjoy, and there's a lot of video game music that I don't like so much, and I tend to focus more on kind of that very smooth feel, right? I love smooth jazz. I love jazz, jazz fusion, bossa nova, lounge, downtempo, just really chilled out music, and there's so much in video game music that reflects that. And I wanted to create something that kind of showcases that sound. And, you know, it's an ode to The Wave, which was that still is a classic smooth jazz station based out of Los Angeles, California. So,
right.
You know, this is The Last Wave with an ode to Outrun.
Nice.
You know, the classic game that, you know, I think inspired a lot of this, I don't know, smooth aesthetic and kind of this direction with these beachy, loungy, bossa-inspired jams. And so this is, you know, the show focuses a lot on that.
Yeah, and you know, I think that there's a lot of, that shares a lot of the same views as a lot of people in the VGM community too, and just game, like gamers and stuff as, you know, as a group, because this kind of music goes so well with so many different styles of games. And I think there's a special place for that. Not only those kind of games, but really like the kind of atmosphere for any type of game that you really need that, that sense of tranquility almost in where you're at in that, whether it be a story or, you know, on a boat or, you know, wherever you are. So, it's really awesome. And today, this game that we're talking about is all about hot air balloons. And I don't know if there's anything more relaxing than being up in the air in the sky with no engine in a big giant, picnic basket, you know, like.
Yeah.
Just sort of going where the wind takes you, quite literally.
Yes. So why did you decide on doing this game for the show? Because this was your idea.
This was my idea, yeah. And so, you know, I saw this, you know, as a host of a podcast centered around music, you got to do a lot of research. You got to listen to a lot of stuff and try to find, you know, pick out those gems that really fit the theme of the show. And I saw this cover art, which was done by a Japanese pop artist named Hiroshi Nagai. And it's got hot air balloons, it's got palm trees, it's got a pool. You know, everything aesthetically looks like it's going to be a hit when it comes to the music. And so I took a listen, and it's got a lot of weird kind of otherworldly sounds, but it fits that smooth, that chill kind of vibe that you're going for based on just the cover art. So it feels like the perfect soundtrack for exploring the world in a hot air balloon. It kind of takes you on a journey.
I like it. You know, that track that we came in with was the opening demo theme, and you hear this right as the game's right before it hits the title screen, I believe. And I gotta say, it's the most hypnotic and nauseating part of like the whole experience, because you're going around, you're floating up in this tube of like images of like different different scenery, and everything
like TV screens.
Yeah, it's like TV screens, but like it's rotating, and I swear to God, it makes me want, like, it's the worst effect to use in that situation. But it does lay a nice kind of groundwork for the rest of the soundtrack. I think it's you know, very short. It's like 40 seconds long.
Yeah. And that leads directly into the menu track, because it was just so short. I mean, we're no fancy tricks from our end. That's it.
That's all you got. we didn't chop it off early. So what'd you think about that one?
I think it's great. I mean, it's so smooth. You know, it's the opening demo. You can't give too much away, and neither does this track. I mean, it leaves you wanting more, which is kind of the perfect way to entice you into playing a hot air balloon simulator.
Right. Well, then that leads right into the menu track, which is really strange, actually.
It is.
And so this one, it has this strange kind of like ambient noise in the back that just kind of perpetuates through the whole track. And I don't know what I could put my finger on to describe it, but it's almost like they have like almost water running in the background. It's almost like that, like a tone that kind of muffles out the rest of the samples.
You know, I was playing this one last night, and what I thought was weird listening to it up close, so to speak, is in the game, it's really actually pretty far in the background, but here, when you're listening to it to listen to it, that piano just sets a weird tone. It does not feel like a chill out menu music.
Yeah.
It doesn't really seem like the vibe for the rest of the soundtrack, but it's certainly an unusual one.
Yeah, this track is, it's weird, it's dissonant, it's kind of got this, like you said, like this weird futuristic ambience in the background, and then you add in the piano and it's a little haunting. It kind of sounds like a mix of like, you know, some sort of industrial elements with like this acid jazz. And then there's like that weird fluctuation in the tempo. It's almost unnerving in a way.
Yeah. So let's talk about this game a little bit, and we'll jump into it. There's not a lot there. It's actually, we're going to spend most of our time talking about the music. On September 11th of 1997, a small company called Artdink, known for their popular A-Train series, released this game called Kaze no Notam. If you're not familiar with Notam, that actually means, we looked that up. What was it?
It was Notice to All Airmen or something like that?
Yeah. Notice to Airmen, some aviation thing. It was basically like, you know, like, hey, here's our route or whatever.
The skies are clear.
Yeah.
Kind of thing, right?
Yeah. So the game is Kaze no Notam, so Notam of the Wind, and it's a hot air balloon simulator for the Sony PlayStation. And Artdink was a company, we haven't talked about them before on the show yet, but they were founded in 1986.
I wanted to do a quick correction there. It's a notice to airmen that the potential hazards along a flight route or a location that could affect the safety of the flight.
Not important. So we didn't talk about Artdink yet on the show. They were founded in 1986. They were actually incorporated in 1986. They could have started a little bit before that, but their website does not give an accurate history at all.
No.
So getting the most that we can. but they started in Narashinoshi, Chiba, and had their first hit, Eireshadeko, the same year. So that was 1985, the end of 1985,
beginning early 86.
Yeah, something like that. But they've done a ton of different series, like the A-Train series, that's what they're most notable for. But then they have like Double Eagle, Lunatic Dawn series, the Carnage Heart series, Tale of the Sun, No One Can Stop Mr. Domino, Sword Art Online, which was kind of a bigger title that I've heard of.
Yeah, that one's a little more recent.
Right. And then there's Axel World versus Sword Art Online. So they've done a few things, but again, like their bread and butter is the A-Train series. And that is a train simulation game that takes place like in real areas, real environments around Japan and the world.
Yeah, it's not like a fantasy simulator. It's right. Kind of true to life.
Now, I do think they have some fictional things depending on the game, the one that has come out. There's like got to be like 15 of these games. So, yeah, I guess it all depends on that.
Yeah, never dipped into those. I think it's almost an annual series, or at least it used to be.
Right. So, Hammock, have you listened to any of the other soundtracks from Artdink, or is this kind of like the one?
I had listened to, I believe it was like some of the Carnage Heart series. I think mm-hmm. they have a couple on the PlayStation and the PSP. Mm-hmm. And I've heard No One Can Stop Mr. Domino. Right. That was a soundtrack that's got a really fun electronic, a lot of electronic music in that one.
Right.
And then I recently listened to the Sword Art Online soundtrack, which features music from Nishida and has a lot of great atmospheric tracks. So that's a cool one to check out.
Yeah. So, I mean, there's a lot of stuff there because Nishida did a lot of the music for, like, pretty much a lot of Artdink stuff. So we'll get more into that as we get through the episode. But why don't we go ahead and jump into our next track? This is Departure, composed by Ryuuji Nishida for Kaze no Notam on the Sony PlayStation.
Thank you.
That was Departure from Kaze no Notam, composed by Ryuuji Nishida.
I like this one a lot. this is the track that grabs me.
Yeah. Those transitions between the different sections are jarring but totally fitting. I don't know how they manage it, but it just works perfectly every time.
Yeah, a lot of strange filtering on the everything. And, you know, this reminds me of the first part of it reminds me a lot of Phantasy Star Online for the Dreamcast. The lobby area where it's like really like laid back. Go back and listen to that, and then listen to this track again, and then tell me it doesn't sound like that. It does.
I got the Serpent Trench from Final Fantasy VI in that very beginning part.
Okay. What'd you think about this, Brandon?
Yeah, it's definitely cool. I mean, it kind of has this weird dark space ambience to it, you know, almost retro science fiction sounding. You know, you hear the creepy sound of an ambulance or like a beeping satellite passing by. I don't really know what that is. distorted computer sounds and muffled transmission. And then, you know, it feels like you blasted into space. And then I really like that jazz section in there with the organ and the piano.
Yes.
But you get the sense that you're flying high over the world.
Yeah. No, I mean, this is what I guess I'd picture if I was in a hot air balloon.
Yeah,
what else you got?
The internet basically is like vaporwave before vaporwave.
I know.
This is right on the money.
Before it was cool. Yeah. I mean, actually, well, no. Anyways.
Doesn't feel ironic here, at least.
Doesn't feel ironic. Let's get to our next track. This is Customize. And this, to kind of give you a sense of where this plays and why you would probably never care, is that you actually get to customize. Well, maybe this is cool. You get to customize your own hot air balloon.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You get to, and it's very strange because you only get to customize, you only get to color the polygons that make up a balloon. So they're all these triangles that, you know, whatever.
It's a little bit of freedom. You know, you can just personalize your hot air balloon or just pick from one of the defaults. That's what I did.
Yeah, because no imagination, Gene.
No, none at all.
This is Customize, composed by Ryuuji Nishida.
Thank you.
All right, that was Customized, composed by Ryuuji Nishida from Kaze no Notam.
Ooh, it's the best.
Ooh, yeah.
I take it back. One. This is the vaporwave track. It's the city poppiest of all.
Yes.
Yeah. Anytime you get like reverb on every percussion instrument, you know, there's like, oh, it's so good, man. So good.
And those birds start you off, it's really implying all of the soaring you're going to do.
Which is funny because this is the track. This is one of the few tracks where you're not even in a balloon.
You're looking at one though.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's inspiring you to create your dream hot air balloon. I mean, this is probably my favorite track of the game.
And
it's the one that I featured on my show, The Last Wave, because it does. I mean, it hits all those cool city pop sensibilities. And, you know, I love that early 80s guitar riff that cuts in there.
Right.
I can't think of better customization music.
I was just listening to your show on the way over here, and I thought you had played this one in a previous episode, and it is the perfect fit if you hadn't already.
Oh, yeah. This is a great track.
This is great, yeah. I don't really have much more to say about it, but just, man, can we just listen to it again?
Just, end the show right here.
Just end the show and just loop it like 20 more times. That was good. We haven't talked about Ryuuji Nishida yet on our show.
No, he hasn't come up too much.
Yeah, he started working at Artdink and stayed with the company for over 20 years, starting in mid to late 90s. Not only is he an established composer, but he's also the head of the sound department and active as the central figure in sound production. He's worked on a ton of different things. We talked earlier about No One Can Stop Mr. Domino, Zeus II, Carnage Heart, Carnage Heart Portable, Lunatic, Dawn Odyssey, A-Train DS, 3D, Dragon Ball Z, Sword Art Online, which, Hammock, you just said you had been listening to, right?
Yeah,
And then a few others. And I guess he had some ties with Ryu Umemoto. I'm not sure exactly to what degree, but he had done some music for the Umemoto tribute album as a contributing arranger. He was also a member of a group called Geon Dan, which is a VGM composer group or alliance that was also led by Yuji Takanouchi, not the Beatmania guy, but the other one. And so there was a lot of people in there, like over 100 different people in this group that was just kind of this kind of collaborative effort of composers, game artists and sound designers and stuff like that, all coming together to either share ideas or meet up and, you know, kind of work on how they can get their music out there or, you know, sell it, make better money, or have even almost like this little union between them. So
yeah, I feel like the Japanese VGM guys are fairly tight knit. I mean, you know, country's not too big, industry's not too big. I was just seeing some album series recently and they had guys like from 30, 35 years back on the same album as people from a few years ago.
Right.
So, I mean, that's super cool that this group exists. I actually had not heard of it, but I guess
it pops up. It's not really something that we would talk about too much on the show unless one of the members was in it and we happened to like bring it up in that context. But otherwise, I mean, it was just kind of like this alliance that, you know, kind of went through a few different phases. And I don't know if it's still around in, you know, what detail it is, but apparently they still have, you know, something going on. So
sure. Yeah.
Cool. But you wanted to bring up this sound designer because you had
got some information. Yeah. So Yasuyuki Suzuki, he often gets credited as the composer on this game because credits are sometimes a little, you know, mixed up. I've seen him listed, but he was actually the sound designer for Kaze no Notam, not the composer. But he did work as a composer on quite a lot of other things. He's worked on the game Ikari no Yosai 2, or Fortified Zone, I think is what it's called in English.
Right, but this one is kind of a different game, but yeah.
Yeah. The series, I think, is called Fortified Zone.
Right.
Operation Logic Bomb, which is the Super Famicom game that came after those. Tale of the Sun. The N64 and GameCube Doshin games, Doshin the Giant. He worked on the PSP Monster Kingdom Jewel Summoner. Lux Payne for the DS, which I think is an adventure game. I was looking at that one a little while ago. And Space Invaders Extreme, where he wrote a couple of songs. Most of those he was actually listed as either sound or music, sound effects, composition. It's kind of hard to tell sometimes. It's sort of mixed all in there. We'd probably have to get him on the show one of these days.
Yeah, I mean, eventually. We see most of these guys with sound effects or something like that. It's unclear what their role actually is. But usually when we see something else that's like, okay, this is sound, and then somebody else is like composition, then we're like, okay, that they yeah. just they didn't know how to like actually label that
group. But he's listed as composer on a few games, so it seems like he does write music from time to time. So
right, yeah. And he was a composer at Jalico too for about like 4 or 5 years, so hence the, you know, different games that he worked on. So,
yeah easy mistake to make.
Yeah. Easy mistake to make.
Well, no, I mean, not that he wrote work for Jalico, but I mean, like, I was like he was listed as composer for this game.
All right, so what do we got next?
We got Tranquility.
All right, let's take a listen, and we'll be right back.
Thank you.
that was Tranquility, composed by Ryuuji Nishida for Kaze no Notam. And I really like that one. It's very optimistic. It's this very beautiful piano-driven track. I like the subtle but triumphant background jazz notes. And like a lot of these tracks, there's this great underlying trip-hop beat. It's really great. Cool track.
Yeah, you know, I don't know if I love or hate like some of the samples in here. Like some of them are really strange. Like kind of like warbly and almost they could just be very low quality and I can't really distinguish, because some of the bell sounds and the like the piano keys have that nice reverb and they just sound really round and authentic, whereas, you know, some of the other stuff, especially some of the low bass stuff that they had playing in this track especially, just sounded really kind of dirty and crunchy. But I don't know if that was intentional or it was just a bad sample.
I don't know, because I feel like if this were re-recorded today it'd be a lot cleaner, more spacious
for sure.
And it feels like the house you're in is a little too small for this track.
Yeah.
You said it was optimistic. I got a little bit of a sadder vibe from it, a little bit more nostalgic. I mean, there were some happy moments in it, but there were definitely some spots where it felt like thinking back to better days, you know, a little bit of that kind of thing.
Well, mm-hmm. You know, you're in a balloon and you're looking at the world below you and you're just kind of questioning life, you know, like, do I stay in this hot air balloon or do I, you know?
It's okay to reflect on negative memories too. You know, not everything in life is happy.
Tranquility.
You know, you go back and forth. You're just in your head the whole time.
This next track is called... so let's get into our next track. This next one's called Phantom, and we'll be right back. We'll be right back. That was Phantom, composed by Ryuuji Nishida for Kaze no Notam.
There's so many different things that I love about this track.
It's a good one.
Yeah, and especially in relation to the other tracks that we've heard so far. One, the mood of every track is pretty different.
Like, right.
You hear this kind of, I think a lot of people have this stereotype, right, of electronic music sounding very similar, but I think there's just a fantastic job done of differentiating the sound choices and the mood and, you know, just the elements in the track. This is very similar to the kind of stuff that Boards of Canada was doing around that time. It's a little bit more, I don't know, not dark, but it's a little darker than maybe some of the other tracks.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, there's a great energy to it, but there's also this sense of, like, inquisitiveness to it.
What do you mean by
that? It feels like a very good exploration song. Like, there's this out-of-tune guitar that kind of starts us off, and then it feels like you're kind of moving in a certain direction, and then something changes, and the atmosphere changes, and it gets a little darker, and it gets a little weirder. And I think a lot of these tracks have that, where you have these mix of, you know, kind of hoppy, poppy bass and jazzy notes, and then you have kind of this dark ambience that kind of underlays a lot of these tracks. So, you know, it's not always greener on the other side of the hill. There might be something over there you don't want to see.
Right. You know, the beginning of this track, too, is a little bit different than the rest. I don't think there was any groundwork that they laid out for this, because I felt like Phantom, I know that's just the name of the track, but I did feel it was like a little bit more menacing and upsetting in the beginning, and then it really switched gears or shifted over to a different kind of feeling. It's not as dark, but also has like this kind of mysteriousness to it. The breakbeat, like Hammock was saying earlier, on top, or kind of underneath, excuse me, is what makes these tracks like stand out even more, I think, because it kind of accentuates all of the little flutters of notes that you get like from like maybe a guitar or a piano that is detuned, or just will come in for, you know, a small riff and then fade right out. So mm-hmm. I think it's pretty awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. That, and just that guitar right in the beginning pushes out the sound palette in really interesting ways. Every track, I think, does something like that.
Yeah. So let's shift focus here from the music and talk about the gameplay a little bit. It's not something we've brought up too much yet, other than you're in a big hot air balloon. But the game, when it starts up, you have a few different options. So it starts off, you get a menu where you can change your, there's like a try mode, memory card options, different rounds that you can play and stuff like that. You want to go through some of those, Gene?
Yeah, so I don't know if there's much to talk about in the options. You know, it's your usual...
Yeah, just
thing.
Skip it.
Yeah. So, you know, try task is probably the main menu or the main option or one of the more common ones. It's a little bit like Pilotwings. You start off, you have some tasks that you can do. There's fly to a certain target. There's maneuver to a different point on the map. Or, I don't know, I guess you can compete with other people in the wolf hunt. I didn't play that one.
Yeah, so, I didn't play that one either.
But they're kind of like light objectives to get you to pick where you want to start on the map and where you want to get to and just explore different spots.
Right.
The round mode just gives you a series of challenges you have to complete. And at least at the beginning, you start off with having three different locations that you can pick from.
See, I think there's a lot more like later on.
I didn't play far enough to see, but I would imagine so. Or yeah, at least maybe different variations on those same three areas. I don't know. What can you tell us, Hammock?
Yeah, the only three locations that I saw was one called Draft Valley, which, you know, has forests, mountains, and castles. It's a very dreamy, almost fantasy-like environment. And then you have Windy City, which is your modern metropolis. You've got office buildings and a stadium and an airport. And then you have Breezy Earth, which is kind of Earth's desolate future. So a lot of canyons. It looks almost like Mars. And those are the only three locations I saw as well. So there could be some more.
You know, the kind of gripe I have about this, because you guys all played it, right?
I did, yeah.
Yeah.
I watched a playthrough video because I don't have the capability to play it, but I saw all the different mini games you can do.
You're totally good for not, like, there's a, like, you can watch somebody play it and you could hold a controller in your hand. Like, I could give my son like a controller that's not plugged in and like he would think he's playing because there's almost no. Well, so it's a
that's how I felt while I was playing it.
It's
actually
a hot air balloon sim, but you can't really change the wind direction. So just, I don't know. Like, I wanted to love it because, like, I really like flying games, like, you know, like Pilotwings or, you know, like, I paraglide is one of my hobbies. And so I really like this kind of in the sky, having total freedom and be able to control like where you are in the atmosphere. But I didn't get that sense. You can go up and down, but when the wind comes in, you don't really have a say in it. You know what I mean? And this is the same thing for a hot air balloon. Like, it's awesome being up in the air, but I can't imagine that actually translates to a game very well, because I wasn't getting that sense of like, whoa, I'm like way up here. And I mean, it was cool, but not, it's not going to keep my attention more than like a few minutes.
It almost feels like the objectives shouldn't have been there. I mean, if you really just want to fly around and see the sights, they probably should have made it a little bit less like goal oriented and more just like, here's a world sim, kind of fly around, see what's there.
Right. Well, what's awesome is you can at least pause the game and change the background music. So you can pick any of these tracks for the most part, except for like, you know, customized menu and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's actually quite a few tracks you can pick.
Yeah. But I mean, the game itself, gameplay, I mean, like I said, it didn't hold my attention for that long. Some of the locations are kind of neat. Like during, in the city, I did watch a playthrough here because I didn't get that far into it. But like, I noticed that the wind speed is really fast, so you kind of like whip around the city pretty quick. And so maybe that's a little exciting, you know, trying to not hit the top of a skyscraper or something.
Well, one thing we didn't mention is you can actually switch what conditions you start the level in. So you can say clear, rainy, windy, sunny, like daytime, nighttime.
And I don't think you would even get into a hot air balloon if it's raining, right? Like, I don't think...
Probably not. But in the game, it's sort of like, well, you can experiment what it would be like with wind conditions and right. rain and whatnot. So like at least you can...
Tornadoes.
Yeah, I don't know about that in this game, but I think it's a cool idea, at least.
Totally. Totally cool idea. I think it's just, like, had a weird... It was a weird place in time where, like... Like that weird, that transition from like 2D to 3D and all these like small companies, like trying to put like their spin or get their, you know, foot in the door with 3D. I just felt like there was so much weird experimentation in this PlayStation Saturn era, 3DO, like that just some of it worked and some of it didn't. And this game is kind of like a big question mark. Like I don't like dislike the game, but I just don't know why. Like, I don't understand.
But, yeah. You know, personally, I love that kind of stuff. I definitely give points for creativity.
Oh, so I like it for that.
I would have been annoyed if I had bought the game and spent like $50 on it and, you know, been done with it in an hour. But you know, I think it's super cool that they were trying something that hadn't been done before or didn't really fit the mainstream mold.
Right. Right. You got anything to add, Hammock?
Yeah, based on the videos that I was watching, I mean, it definitely looks like it plays like a very chill Pilotwings. And, it, you know, to me, with the music playing and just the slow motion of the balloon kind of at the mercy of the wind, it feels more like it was an interactive music record than an actual video game. Like, you could just leave, you just turn this on, leave the balloon flying, and just listen to the music and just chill out. And that's all you gotta do. And maybe you'll crash into a mountain at some point, but...
I can see that, yeah.
That's a good point, though. I mean, like, really, I think this game's more of like a fun kind of interactive tech demo and something that you can kind of kick back and actually not use too much brain power for. You know, I mean, there's a lot of games that don't require a lot of brain power, but this is like almost none, as far as I can tell.
Hey, I mean, there are some cool things to see. Like, it's not immediately obvious when you start that you can fly, and there's like sometimes pyramids and castles, and it's like, it's this weird world that kind of exposes parts of itself to you over time, and you have to go and see it. It's not immediately obvious. It's not really... I don't know if it's a strong enough thing to keep your interest in the game long term.
Look, I'm giving it like a hard time, but actually I do like the game. I do like the game for the most part. It's yeah. It's not like the most amazing thing, and there's not really a lot there, and I think hot air balloon idea for a game is probably like, I don't know if that was probably a financially sound idea, but regardless, I do like, there's a lot of things about it I do like, for yeah, sure.
For sure.
Yeah. Let's get into some more music.
We got two tracks back to back here. These are interesting ones. So we mentioned that there's some objectives that you can complete during the level, and you get different music based on whether you complete the task or if you don't. And so we're going to play those back to back, the task completed and then the task failed. So we'll break in between, but first we're going to play the task completed music. We'll be right back. That was Task Completed from Kaze no Notam, composed by Ryuuji Nishida.
I like this one. This is a pretty jam. I like it. It's a lot more energetic, and I think it's kind of like Task Complete is happy move because, you know, something happened and you did a good job, so you should get a little celebration. So I like it.
It's not so stereotypically triumphant, though, which is what I really like about it. Like, yeah. I think a lot of games have this sort of, like, you know, major key, everything's super happy. You did it. You won. This one's a little bit
those
like...
Those bending guitar or chords are really rad. Really
yeah,
rad.
Yeah.
It reminds me a little, like, of demo scene kind of culture right into the some of those notes. The wow, wow.
Like a little James Brown funk lick in there, too. Sure, like, yeah, good job.
Hammock, tell us your thoughts.
Yeah, it gets down. It's a celebration, but, you know, like Gene was saying, it's a little foreboding. I mean, the longer it plays out, the more it becomes kind of this cautionary tale. Like, okay, you've successfully completed this task. Very cool, but get ready, because here comes another task. And, yeah, I love the organ in the track. That's really cool. There's, you know, this kind of dissonance to it that really adds to it. But, yeah, cool track.
Yeah, it's really cool, but I got to question why it's as long as it is, because I can't imagine you'd be on the screen for very long, because after you see your tasks, after you see your stats on, like, what the, you know, after you complete stuff, you get this rundown of, like, here's, you know, how long it took, the wind direction, you get all these, like, different stats. You're on that screen for just a minute, and then you get into the next, you know, task. So I don't know how many people would have actually heard all the way through, because the track is quite long. It's, like, several minutes long, right? So,
Yeah,
I like it, though. I thought it was really good.
Yeah, I mean, people might be just sitting on the screen for a little while, too, and just sort of marveling at their accomplishment.
Or they, you know? Yeah, they woke back up. They're like, oh.
The balloon landed.
Oh, yeah. I guess I won. All right. All right, Hammock, what do we got next?
All right, up next, we got Task Failed, because, you know, sometimes you fail a task. And this is Task Failed, composed by Ryuuji Nishida for Kaze no Notam.
Task Failed, composed by Ryuuji Nishida for Kaze no Notam. I love this one.
That's also the sound of me disregarding my flight instructor and going off into the sunset, because I love this one better than Task Completed.
I know.
Oh, definitely.
Me too. I didn't get, so this kind of goes with what Hammock was saying about, like, the, you know, kind of cautionary tale, like, hey, you got something next, right? It wasn't that the last track, the Task Completed, was like a happy sounding. It just was more energetic. And this one, in the same note, I think, is not more, I don't get this sense of sadness in it, but I do feel like the, you know, I'm not up to par. Like, you know, it's like, just go back down to, like, a more mediocre level and start up again.
Yeah, but there's a sense of, like, don't worry about it. You didn't get it this time. You'll get it the next time. It's totally fine. Don't worry.
Totally. Take a nap first. And then you're good.
Yeah, this is great. I love the funky, fresh electronic beat. I mean, losing never sounded so good. It sounds like something from NBA In the Zone. Definitely a good jam. I definitely like this more than the Task Completed. And if they had switched the two and the other one was the Task Failed, you know, I think I would be okay with that, because this is definitely more, oh yeah, sweet, I did it. All right, cool, I can jam out for a little bit.
Yeah, no, I don't.
You know, I can kind of buy that, actually.
Yeah, I don't think it would make any difference. I'm starting to question, like, did we get the wrong track? Oh, anyways, yeah, that was great. That was great. This whole the South soundtrack is like something like odd, but also refreshing too, because there's not a lot of time on the show that we get to really listen to a lot of super chill, like kind of breakbeat, but you know, smooth jams. And so I think this is just a nice kind of relaxing episode. And I'm really happy that we're talking about this today. I gotta say, Hammock, I want to talk about you for a second.
Sure.
First, before I knew your real name, and your real name's Brennan, but I was hoping your real name was Hammock. I was really hoping, like, I was thinking, like, I wonder if his real name, I mean, because that could be a name, right?
That could be. Yeah, if your parents are really cool and yeah. chilled out, then Hammock is a great name.
You're located north of us, right? Like in Oregon area?
I am, yeah, up in
Oregon. See, I mean, that sounds like a Portland name. Like, I would totally buy that. Totally buy that.
Yeah, you work at a food truck, and you know you've got a pottery business on the side. You yeah, know, living up in Portland, doing the whole thing.
Yeah, sitting yeah. in a hammock right now. Like, anyway, yeah. So, how long have you been into like game audio and stuff? Like, tell us a little bit about your history and like why you kind of like started, you know, listening to game music and then decided to do a podcast.
So I, you know, as a kid, getting a Super Nintendo was a big deal. And I played a lot of Super Nintendo. I was big into the RPGs, a lot of the Squaresoft RPGs, Chrono Trigger, Secret of Mana, those were all some of my real favorites. And I grew up in Dallas, Texas, and there was a store there called Planet Anime. And I went there one time with my parents, and I found the Chrono Trigger soundtrack on CD. And I got it. And I listened to it, and I was like, wow, this is, you know, video game music is really awesome. And from there, I kind of, you know, wasn't so much seeking it out, but whenever I would stumble across it or find it or you know, save up enough money to buy another CD, I would buy one and listen to it. And then, you know, when MP3s became more of a thing, then you could easily find stuff like that. And that was the kind of the initial love of video game music. But what developed into my love of smooth video game music was more, you know, kind of when the podcasts of these VGM podcasts came out. You know, Legacy Music Hour, Your Show, VGM Jukebox. Those are the ones that got me back into video game music. You know, I'd fallen out of playing video games, so I wasn't really up to speed with the music and the games. And then listening to these podcasts and the accessibility to a lot of these soundtracks really helped me kind of rejuvenate my love. And at that point in my life, you know, my musical taste had transitioned more into jazz and just bossa nova, a lot of chill music. And so I wanted to find the tracks that really spoke to me. And, you know, I think having a platform to share those is really, really fun for the community. You know, it's a very niche sound and you're either into it or you're not. But I think, you know, at least providing a kind of a curation of these songs is cool and fun.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think it's fun to discuss and talk about it too, because, you know, it's not every day that, I mean, I think it's becoming more of a acceptable thing to do, right? I mean, how many VGM shows are actually out now? There's a bunch.
Yeah, so many.
For sure.
And that's awesome, though. That's awesome, because if it were just one, then that would say something about the medium, right? I think that would speak it, like, you know, that it is that niche of a thing. But because there's so much around video games, video game music, and we're talking about games, but we're not talking about the actual gameplay as much as we are the music. I mean, the focus is the music. And I think that because there's so many, shows that it's a growing medium. You know, it's like it's developing a lot more fans of, you know, like straight VGM fans, you know. And so I think that's so awesome. And the fact that, you know, I think we're in the same boat, and I think Gene's the same way. Like, we've all kind of had that, you know, we played games and we loved the music and stuff, but we didn't really pursue it or, you know, go out of our way to discover it more really until, you know, it would, like, things would pop up and every now and then. But then, like, you know, this kind of resurgence of accessibility, you know, especially like Napster and stuff, I was able to find so much stuff again, you know.
Same,
because
yeah.
It just wasn't, and a lot of these were like recordings that people had done, you know, like VGM rips wasn't a thing. You know, there was some NSF files and stuff, but it was very minimal, you know. And so I think the evolution and stuff, we're going to see a lot more VGM podcasts pop up. And I think that's an awesome thing.
Yeah. And one of the things before I decided to do the podcast, I was actually living in Portland and I, you know, applied for the X-Ray FM, which is their local radio station, their independent radio station, with this idea of, like, you know, having an hour on Sunday nights to play just cool, laid back video game music. and they picked it up. And unfortunately, we left Oregon completely, and I went back to Texas to deal with some family issues, and so it never really came to fruition. But, you know, my wife encouraged me. She said, you know what, just do the same thing you were going to do, but turn it into a podcast. And,
yeah,
and that's what happened. But that, you know, just goes to show that there is this sort of accessibility, and there's, you know, more of an increase of popularity of video game music, that they're willing to pick it up and play it on a radio station and give it a chance to be spread to more ears, which is really cool.
And I'm curious how this is going to change over the next generation. You know, like, we grew up with Super Nintendo and Nintendo, like, sure, you know, like, yeah, the earlier
kind of the
generation.
Retro now.
Yeah, retro now. And so we kind of like, we like to kind of reminisce on some of that, but also kind of, you know, retell a story that may have been lost, you know, as far as like the, you know, composition side goes. But, you know, moving forward to like the next generation, like my kids' generation, like, what are they going to be into? Like, how is music, video game music is going to be a lot more mainstream than it is even now. But what are they going to be listening to? What video game music, you know? Are they going to go back to the retro stuff? Are they going to stick with more modern stuff? Or, well, is retro going to be the PlayStation 4?
So I got to say, I have a bit of an answer to that because, you know, as part of what you were saying, Hammock, a lot of what we do here on the show is research. And I've been trying to dig as much as I can into more modern stuff. And, you know, it's hard because we don't have time to play the games, but the music out there is so good now.
Like, yeah, it's
there's
so good.
So many great soundtracks. Mm-hmm. I mean, the medium has changed. It's a lot more dynamic music. It's sometimes harder to find stuff that stands on its own, but there's proportionally probably just as much or more great music out there. And I've got a ton of really cool stuff that I hope we get to explore and maybe talk to some of those composers as time goes on. So I don't think there's any shortage of stuff to talk about for people that come after us. We don't just have to stick to that 8, 16, or 32-bit stuff.
No, for sure. Everything's evolving, so.
Definitely.
Anyways, let's get into another track here. This is called Nature, and this is awfully chill, so let's take a listen, and we'll be right back. Thank you. That was Nature from Kaze no Notam, composed by Ryuuji Nishida.
That track goes places. I gotta say, that very beginning part is the spitting image of what goes on in the wake of Doshin the Giant, that album, if you guys listened to it. And you know what? The sound designer, what was his name? He worked on it. Yasuyuki Suzuki.
Yeah.
So I bet he was like, you know, I worked on this older game that's got this really cool sound of retro synths.
Yeah, like, hey, check this out.
Check this out.
I'll buy you lunch. Put this in.
You know what this really is? It doesn't remind me of it musically, but this track is kind of like the weirdness we've come to expect from the Mother series. You know, Earthbound, Mother 3.
Right.
It's just like... it's wild.
Yeah.
It's got some really big shifts in there. I love it.
And folks, on your left, we are going to pass by the Amphibian Museum. And
yeah.
Whoa. Yeah, it has this weird 1960s Star Trek outer space vibe mixed with this jazz funk section that comes in there. And you know, but like a lot of these tracks, there is that retro science fiction sound. There's that future ambience, these weird kind of beeps and things that come in and out. But yeah, very cool. Very cool journey that it takes you. Makes sense for, you know, again, being up in the air, up in the sky, exploring, just a good sound.
Well, I think the nature of this track, no pun intended, is that they're just going through different scenic views, right? Like through a forest or, you know, through a valley, and you're getting all of these different, you know, kind of nature sounds in there. And then you may go lower and hear like the frogs in the, you know, in the bogs or whatever. And then you may go up in the sky and
hear
like
these
really kind of like soaring, you know, eagle synth sounds.
Pick up a few grays in Area 51.
Yeah.
You know, just the usual ambience.
Totally. Totally. So, let's talk about the graphics a little bit. There's a thing. I'm a fan of the graphics. I think that the environments are really cool. I'm not a fan of the draw distance because it's like you can see like 20 feet in front of you.
Yeah, the pop-in goes by gigantic square by square. It's really kind of disorienting.
Yeah, but some of the stuff is really rad. I mean, like the pyramid's like a big, it's a big pyramid, you know?
Yeah. I mean, the landscape is pretty cool, but you don't know that it's there until you're basically about to smack right into it.
Yeah, yeah. But, I mean, you know.
And PlayStation 1, I mean, I feel like the detail is pretty good, all things considered, and so they made the cuts where they could.
I think the whole point of being in a hot air balloon is to look at the ground, right? To like, you know, not to look at the air, because, I mean, you can see that from the ground.
That's fair, yeah.
So, I mean...
I don't have much else to say about it other than it looks pretty cool.
I think it looks good.
But it's a little bit weird in practice.
So, I wanted... Hammock, I wanted you to bring up the cover art again because there's something kind of interesting around that.
Yeah, definitely. So, the cover art was designed by Hiroshi Nagai, who designed a lot of great 80s Japanese, you know, pop album covers. Moonlight Mystery, A Long Vacation, September Wind by Naoya Matsuoka. Just a lot of cool, you know, city pop, jazz records from the 80s. And, you know, the cover is what drew me into this album because you have these hot air balloons and the palm trees and the pool. And it provides this atmosphere of chill, of just wanting to hang out by the pool and watch hot air balloons flying across the sky. And so, that art really kind of, you know, which makes it feel like an interactive record because you have almost album artwork from a famous, you know, designer of classic 80s Japanese album covers.
Yeah, but don't you think it's kind of strange because this game was released in the late 90s? You know, like the kind of vaporwave or city pop that was like big in the late 70s, early 80s, or, you know, through the 80s. But it was dying out by then, you know? So like to bring this back, kind of rehash this kind of, this culture, into a video game in the late 90s with an artist that was, you know, in his prime in the 80s doing like records. Like, it just feels like such a strange choice for that time period, you know?
Yeah, but you had all those Psygnosis cover art, you know, like the fantasy album covers from like rock and prog album covers. Do you remember who I'm talking about, right?
Oh, yeah.
I feel like it's the same kind of thing, just the Japanese equivalent, like, or at least in this particular case.
For sure. Actually, it's funny because like my wife, like I asked the kind of music she used to listen to and it's all city pop. But like that was like the thing back then, but she didn't call it city pop, so... anyways, but cool. Did you, so you said that you watched a playthrough. How far did you get into it?
I watched all three of the little mini games. So the fly-in where you hit a target on the ground, the wolf hunt where you find another balloon and basically mark it and knock it down. And then the tri-delta, which is creating, you know, a triangle based on three different points on the map. And gotcha. So it was playthrough through each of the cities, or each of the levels. And, yeah, but, you know, like a very chill Pilotwings, just very slow moving. And then you have this, you know, constantly emerging landscape below you, you know, that kind of, what do they call it? The fog of war, where yeah. it slowly dissipates and you see another polygon and another polygon.
Yeah. It's just not that far. It's,
right. Yeah.
It's not that far, man. Yeah. I mean, yeah.
You are pretty high up in the air though. So, I mean, on a PlayStation 1 game, I think
that's the best you're going to get.
Yeah. Nowadays, if they did it, you'd be able to see for miles. I mean, hey, Microsoft Flight Sim is about to come out, and that game is like real graphics, like basically map photography
that
at this point.
Is, yeah, I know. The game blows my mind. It looks so incredible. But anyways, yeah, Hot Air Balloon. You know what? I'll tell you what. If they re-release this game for the Switch or you know, something, I'd be for it.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah, you update the graphics, you get the same soundtrack, and I think it would be a real hit.
Oh yeah, totally. And in fact, I think like they could even get him to do like a rehash. You know how like Kobayashi-san did a reimagination of Panzer Dragoon Saga, you know, get Ryuuji-san to like do a reimagination of this with you know, maybe
better synths,
yeah, like
nicer,
a Korg or yeah. something instead of the PlayStation hardware, and you'd be set. Anyways, let's get into almost our last track here. This is called Solitude, composed by Ryuuji Nishida.
Thank you.
Right, that was Solitude, composed by Ryuuji Nishida for the Sony PlayStation game Kaze no Notam.
This is one of my favorite tracks. This is really good. It's on the longer side, but I think it's like totally worth it. It's got just enough energy to keep you interested, but not enough to take you away from what you're doing. So I listened to a lot of the soundtrack, and I mean most of it, throughout the last few weeks while I was working, and it was great background music. Like I could let my mind, like the music would keep my attention, but also I was able to concentrate on a task. And that, for me, that's a special quality, because not a lot of game music can really do that. I listen to a lot of game music while I work, but I don't always absorb the sound the same way. And I think that something like as ambient as this really keeps me in like the right mood and mindset to be productive. And so I like this track a lot. I felt like it's very nice. The pacing is really nice, and it does feel very, you know, I guess productive sounding, even though it's supposed to be like this, you know, track in solitude. So.
Yeah. And what a fitting title, right? I mean, it really feels very peaceful. Probably one of the more peaceful tracks in this whole soundtrack. And, you know, I kind of had a similar experience to you, not quite in the same way. Like when I first listened to the soundtrack, I thought it was pretty good. I didn't quite get into it, but I kept coming back to it over the weeks. I would just like put on a random track or start the playlist and listen to it pretty much all the way through. And I found this one, I found myself stopping on a lot and wanting to like listen to it more actively. It works really well in a background context, but it's got this nice, just sort of hypnotic groove.
Yes.
But in like, you can zone in and out as much as you want, and it lets you do that just because there's so many of these repetitive elements and these nice melodies that are swirling in and out. I don't know what else to say other than I probably, again, one of my favorites on the soundtrack for sure. And I kind of wanted to end with it or be pretty close to it because it'd be a nice background as we take out the show, you know?
Yeah, so in the playthrough video that I watched, this track was set to the breezy earth level. So, you know, you have this desolate landscape, the sense that you really are in solitude, that there's nobody else on this planet. So there is something very haunting about this track. You know, there's these weird kind of radio transmissions that come in and out. At the beginning, there's almost like this siren sound. It's very ominous. It sounds like a monster awakening, like some sort of giant kaiju.
I was gonna bring that up. You know, that was the only part of the track that threw me off, and I was a little bit like, I could have used that not being in there a little bit more, because that was the part that actually took me away from my peacefulness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's weird. It's a little you know, it's a little out of place. And then that electro pop beat hits, and it's so good. And then you have that guitar that shreds in right when it needs to. So yeah, I like this track a lot.
Right, that's a good one. Man, this soundtrack is just so awesome, so good, and I'm glad we got a chance to talk about it today. So today we covered Kaze no Notam on the Sony PlayStation, composed by Ryuuji Nishida. Had a lot of fun. And just really great soundtrack to listen with both you guys.
Yeah, real hidden gem. I've loved listening to this. I've loved getting ready for this show. I'm really glad we had you on, Hammock, and I hope we can have you on again for future shows. You know, keep digging through the pile and find some great stuff. We'll definitely take a listen.
Anytime we have a track that like lowers my heart rate, we'll have to invite you on. It just like totally works. Totally.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
Yeah. So if you want to know more about our show, you can check us out online at pixelatedaudio.com for our show notes and the track list. And we can also be found on Twitter at Pixelated Audio, and of course, Discord as well. If you're not in the Discord channel, go to the website. There is a link to join in from there. Hammock's in there. Gene's in there. I'm in there. We're all active, and it's a good time.
Yeah, you can always leave comments or feedback on the website. Leave us an iTunes review, which is very much appreciated. You know, any way you want to give us feedback, email is great too. Contact at Pixelated Audio. We're definitely open to hearing what people have to say. We're trying to get through the backlog of lots of different things, you know.
Right. We're working on it. We're getting there. Hammock, where can we find you?
Yeah, you can check out my show, KVGM, The Last Wave, on iTunes. New shows come out every Sunday. It's 30 minutes of smooth jam, so, you know, perfect for your morning commute. You can find me on Twitter at KVGM Radio, and then you can check out the website, kvgmradio.blogspot.com, if you want to learn more about the show.
And we will put those links in our show notes as well.
Yeah, and I can attest it is perfect for a morning commute.
A Monday morning especially.
Yeah.
I'm to it tomorrow.
Driving, and I'm a little bit stressed out, and I'm like, you know, those dulcet tones of Hammock and his sweet jams definitely bringing my energy down to where it needs to be instead of angry.
Awesome. I appreciate it.
Awesome. If you're new to our podcast and you want to check out some of our past episodes, we've done one about teeth.
Yeah, that was a weird one.
Yeah, that was a strange one. That was our last episode, Colgate, or Harold Heartland, and the adventure for clean teeth, or was it something like that?
Yeah, the fight for clean teeth. I did want to bring up one specific one that's a little bit more in line with this, although a lot harder. You have, what's the episode number?
Well, I don't know. Tell me what the game
Ghost is. In the Shell. Here we go. Episode 31. That's way back.
If you but that's a lot more trance.
It is a lot more trance. But if you like just a show focused on electronic music, basically, you know,
yeah.
A little bit more of something that you might buy an album for and just stick it in your CD player or whatever people listen to on these days.
That's fair.
That's a great one. It's definitely a bit of an older show. So if you aren't caught up, it's one of my favorites. I definitely love hard trance, though. So hard trance dance, whatever.
Nice. So, Hammock, we got one final track. Take another show. What do we got?
Of course, this is the staff roll. So it's a great callback to customize. It's the dreamy version of it. Again, the composer is Ryuuji Nishida, and this is Kaze no Notam. Thank you.